the crosses, row on row, that mark our place, and in the sky, the larks, still briefly singing, fly, scarce a herd amidst the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe, to you from failing hands we throw, the torch be yours to hold it high, if ye break faith with us who die. We shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields.
During the First World War, much of fighting took place in Western Europe. Previously beautiful countryside was blasted, bombed, and fought over again and again. The landscape swiftly turned to fields of mud. Bleak and barren scenes where little or nothing could grow. Bright red Flanders poppies were delicate but resilient flowers and grew in their thousands, flourishing even in the middle of chaos and destruction. In early May 1915, shortly after losing a friend in Ypres, a Canadian doctor, Lieutenant Colonel John McCrae, was inspired by the sight of poppies to write a now famous poem called In Flanders Fields.
This time of the year is a time for us to remember. It is a time when we remember the horrors of conflict and the lives lost for our freedom. We show our respects by wearing a poppy.
Poppy is a very special symbol that reminds us of something specific. It's a symbol of Remembrance Day. The poppy is a flower reminding people of the importance of life. It became a symbol of hope on the battlefields. On Remembrance Day, we remember soldiers, servicemen, and women who died or were wounded. Many soldiers in World War I were very young.
They were only teenagers, some were as young as us. When they left their homes, their families, many were killed. Even more suffered injuries that changed their lives. Families lost sons, brothers, fathers and uncles.
Several memorial sites where we saw lots of large fields covered in row after row of small wooden crosses, each one representing a soldier who was killed in different battles. There were literally thousands upon thousands of these crosses, practically as far as the eye could see, and this visual representation really brought home the horrible reality of the number of dead soldiers. On the second day, we visited a British memorial called Thiepval. Here there was again a vast memorial building which was covered with 72,000 names of soldiers who had died in World War I. These names were of soldiers who had no known grave anywhere, just their names engraved on this memorial. It was sad to think that their families didn't have a grave to visit, but at least they had this memorial where they could go to remember them.
We took the coach everywhere. Everybody was shocked about how many cemeteries we drove past. Everywhere we went, we drove past at least one cemetery. It brought home the reality of just how many lives were lost during the First World War. We were moved at how well kept the cemeteries were and how much respect it still showed to all soldiers, whether they be British, French, German or Canadian. I have had family members in the army who made me realise how brave the soldiers were and they made the best.
As far as cemeteries go, and as special as other graves are, one grave stood out to the people. One grave visited by thousands and seen almost every day. The grave of a rifleman, whose grave lies next to where John McCrae wrote a now famous poem in Flanders Fields. Here rests Valentine Strudwick, a Canadian, who became the youngest soldier to die on the Western Front after he sacrificed his life and future for his country at the age of 15. His effort saved his country in war, at such an age, to be remembered. As he, at my age, sacrificed himself for us.
Throughout the battlefield trip, many things stood out for me, but one of the biggest was the land damage. the second last day we went to Ypres in Belgium. In Ypres there is a huge monument to commemorate all the missing men of war. Every night at 8 p.m. people gather in respect for the missing men. Representing Crieff High School, six of us took part in the ceremony. The ceremony starts off with the last post trumpet song. Then in turn, people walk across and lay their wreath on the stand against the wall. This ceremony is very powerful and thought-provoking. For me, this is one of the best nights we spent in Battlefield's trip.
We went to many different cemeteries and there was a clear distinction between the German graves and the British graves. They made the British cemeteries by giving them an English garden appeal, so they were covered in plants and they had clean white headstones. One thing that we noticed was that some headstones were very close together, nearly touching, and others were spread out. They were close together because of mass bombing, so they weren't able to identify the individual people. I think that hit everybody really hard. In the German cemeteries, there were rows upon rows of crosses, and what was really emotional is that there were mainly four or more men buried under the same cross. Words can't even describe how much respect we all have for every soldier.
Officially known as the Third Battle of Ypres, Passchendaele became infamous not only for the scale of casualties, but also for the mud.
Ypres was the principal town of the Salient or Bulge in the British lines and the site of two previous battles, the first one taking place between October and November 1914, and the second one taking place between April and May 1915.
Jacob long wanted a British offensive in Flanders, and following warning that a German blockade would soon cripple the British war effort, wanted to reach the Belgian coast to destroy the German submarine bases there.
On top of this, the possibility of a Russian withdrawal from the war threatened German redeployment from the Eastern Front to increase the reserve strength dramatically.
The infantry attack began on the 31st of July. Constant shelling had turned the clay soil and smashed the draining systems. The left wing of the attack achieved its objectives, but the right wing failed completely.
Within a few days, the heavy stream for 30 years had turned into a soil, into a quagmire, producing thick mud that clogged up rifles and immobilised tanks. Eventually came so deep that many horses sank.
On August 16th, the attack was resumed to little effect. Stalemate reigned for another month until improvement in the weather prompted another attack on the 20th of September. The Battle of Menin Road Ridge, along with the Battle of Polygon Wood on 26th September, and the Battle of Wood Sound on 4th of October, established British possession of the ridge east of Ypres.
Further attacks in October failed to make much progress. The eventual capture of what little remained of Passchendaele village by British and Canadian forces on the 6th of September finally gave Haig an excuse to call off the offensive and claim success.
Together for the greater good. Ethos is really important and it's important for us
into that ethos to feel that we belong. Resilience. The ability to keep going. The ability, when you feel and you've been knocked down, to get back up again with a positive attitude. The ability to keep going, to overcome the difficulties, to recognise the positives that you do have, to recognise the supports you have to help you, and to keep moving forward. Also want to talk about values. Here I'm looking at the values that are on the Scottish Mace in the Scottish Parliament. Wisdom. In terms of remembrance, let's have some wisdom. Let's reflect on what's happened and try and ensure that we learn from those lessons to make the future better. Justice. It's important that we have justice. It's important that we have fairness, that we have equality, that we have equity. And think about our part that we play in that of being part of a bigger culture. Compassion. Many of the men and women who've endured all operations in war have survived because of compassion of people around them. That kindness. Try and be kind in everything you do. It doesn't cost anything to be kind, but it means a lot to lots of people. The fourth value is that I am going to talk about, integrity. That's about being honest, but more importantly, being honest with yourself. Knowing what you believe in, sticking to the beliefs, doing the right thing, not being swayed by other people, not following the crowd, but doing what the right thing is and standing up for what's right. The C I want to talk about is the comrades. That's why men and women fight. They fight for the man and the woman beside them. They fight for their family. They fight for their friends. They fight for what they believe is right. They fight for the country. They fight for their community, whether that's local, national, or international. You need to trust those around you. You need to build trust with your comrades. The E I want to talk about is endurance. It's by no surprise that when we talk about fighting through when things are physically arduous, that we soldier on, because that's what soldiers do, that's what the military do. There's no saying, I haven't had my break now, I need to have my lunch hour. I can't drive that vehicle because I've already driven too many hours. I'm too tired, I need to put down my head and rest. You need to be physically robust to serve in the military, and that's something that we can all learn from. But to be physically robust, we need to look after ourselves, both physically and mentally. We need to recognise as well when we need some help and support, and we need to seek that from the community that we've built around us, from our comrades, who that we trust and believe in. So my message that I want to leave with you today when we talk about remembrance and remember all those people that have served us is, what about your service? What are you going to do to serve your school and your community?
I've been reading a book recently by Daniel Levitin, who is a neuroscientist. It's about how our brain works and something that doesn't work. And one of the chapters talks about how we organise our social lives. Basically, we're hardwired almost instinctively to divide the world into two groups. There's us and there's them. And it pans out in different ways in different contexts. Historically, it goes way back thousands, tens of thousands of years to when most people would live in a small family group, extended family, might be as many as 200 extended family. But that's us. We grew up with them. We're related to them. We know each one of them. They know us. But across the hill in the next valley, there's another family group. We don't know them. They're strangers. We're wary of them. They're potentially dangerous. It's them. Occasionally two groups meet and strain each other's territories. There might be a wee battle or something. And that is perpetuated maybe throughout generations. Remember what they did. Or some of the groups even remember what they did. But we just know that they are the baddies, the enemy. And that pans out in many different ways in different contexts, us and them. A small family group, that's where we live. Across the road there's a new family moved in, they're from some other part of the world. We don't know them, we know nothing about them, we're wary of them. That other football team that we don't support, and their supporters, that's them. How can they be so stupid to support that team? But we know, everybody knows, our team's the best. Maybe supporters or followers of another religion, don't know anything about, that's them. We are us. Maybe in the school, you see yourselves as pupils. The teachers are them. There are many different ways in which we divide society, almost instinctively without thinking, into us and them. The most extreme form is when it comes to war, and two nations are divided. And that's what we're thinking about, remembrance. We do this without thinking. Remembrance is a time, however, for thinking, us and them. But at the end of the day, they are actually just the same as us. In that First World War, the very first Christmas, there was a truce. And the Germans lit candles at Christmas Eve. I don't know where they got their Christmas trees from, but they put them on Christmas trees to sign Christmas carols. The trenches were so close that they could hear each other almost talk when the guns fell silent. And they heard them singing Christmas carols. One or two brave souls put their heads above the parapet, discovered they weren't short. They crept out. They shook hands. Passed each other Christmas greetings. The next day, Christmas Day, they exchanged presents. They played football together. They showed each other photographs of their family back home. What would they be doing today while we're out here in no man's land, in the mud, the trenches? That carried on for so long until the superior officers heard what was going on. A truce is one thing, but fraternizing with the enemy is a crime, and they soon put a stop to it. Because they are them, and we are us. We are the goodies, and they are the baddies. They begin to understand that they are actually the same as us. And extremely dangerous in a war situation. You can't have it. The Second World War, the same kind of division. Britain and Germany had always had good relations. The Second World War, they were the Nazis, the nasties, the bad people. So we fought. After the Second World War was over, it's interesting how the balance of power shifted, the boundary between us and them shifted. After the Second World War, the Cold War came in. Now they were the communists, the evil empire ruled by the Mandarins in Russia. East Germany became part of that communist empire. West Germany was had been liberated by the Allies. Berlin was divided into two. Particularly Berlin had a west part of it, which belonged to the Free West, surrounded by East Berlin and East Germany. And the communists blockaded West Berlin, but now West Berlin was part of us, the Free West. The Americans sent aeroplanes over West Berlin and dropped parcels of food and sweeties for the children. I heard about that firsthand, because at that time my grandmother lived in West Berlin. I could still tell and remember with gratitude and these aeroplanes came over, and the people looked forward to it. Us and them. We divide the world into these two groups almost without thinking. But remembrance is a time for thinking. Every soldier killed, no matter what side they're on, leaves behind grieving parents, maybe a widow, maybe a girlfriend who's looking forward to getting married and that's never going to happen. Maybe children who are now orphaned and don't have someone to provide for them. Every single soldier, whether it is us or them. Jesus said something amazing and radical and revolutionary in the context of what Daniel Levitin said about how our brains work. He said, love your enemies. Love them, the stranger, the potential dangerous enemy. The Apostle Paul writes in one of his letters, do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do not be overcome by evil. Overcome evil with good. If our brains work in one particular way without thinking, it's a time for thinking. Think of what the world would be like if we built bridges instead of barriers.
We remember the courage, the comradeship, the spirit of working together for a common cause, the planning together for a better world that will come with peace.
We remember the call to arms, the patriotic songs, the sound of the drums and the bagpipes, the prayers of hope.
Remember the love that was lost, the wisdom of the people that was wasted, the minds that are still pained by memories.
We remember the families who have been bereaved by recent wars and conflict.
We remember this day, the children who will die, while some nations continue to fight against others.
Today we remember that at the 11th hour of the 11th day of the 11th month, the guns fell silent on the Western Front to mark the end of the First World War. Our country and school has recalled that moment through remembrance events down the decades, decades during which the men and women of our armed services have continued to be the ultimate sacrifice, their life for us. And so we stand here today to remember lives sacrificed in the service of our country, and those traumatised and injured in all conflicts. They shall grow not old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them. We will now observe our 2 minute silence.
When you go home, tell them of us and say, for your tomorrow, we give our today.
Together now to pray for all who suffer as a result of conflict, asking that God may give peace. You've got a role to play now. When I say may God give peace, please reply with the echo, God give peace. Let's pray. Today we remember the service men and women who have died in the violence of war. May God give peace. Pray for those who love them in death as in life, who live with grief and the sadness of loss. May God give peace. For all members of the armed forces who are in danger today, remembering family, friends, and all who pray for their safe return, may God give peace. For civilian women, children and men whose lives are disfigured by war or terror, by the anger and hatred of fellow human beings, may God give peace. For peacemakers and peacekeepers who seek to keep this world secure and free, may God give peace. For all who bear the burden and responsibility of leadership, political, military and religious, asking for gifts of wisdom and resolve in the search for reconciliation and peace, may God give peace. God of truth and justice, we hold before you those whose memory we cherish, those whose names we will never know. Help us in this broken world to find the grace to pray for those who wish us harm. And as we honour the past, give us faith in your future, for you are the source of life and hope, now and forever. Amen.